Good morning. Welcome to the United Church of Annapolis worship service. I'm Kathy McFadden, your moderator, and I'll be presenting you the upcoming events for the week. And Kathleen, thank you for that piece of music. That's one of my favorite, and it just gives me hope. Appreciate it very much. Quick update. Thank you for all your prayers for my little great nephew Braxton, who had his second brain surgery this week from doctors from St. Jude. He came through very successfully. They accomplished everything they needed to. And in 2 weeks, he'll be starting to go through chemo and radiation at the same time. We're very hopeful, and lots of prayers need to be said, because sometimes that's all we got. But anyway, appreciate it very much. Thank you for keeping in our prayers. And Carl, I hope you're doing well too, and recovering fairly quickly. Please put all of your posts, or please post all of your prayers that you would like for a pastor to mention anytime in the chat. It's great to have them before the prayers start so we can have those ready to go. Don't forget coffee hour right after the service. Your link is on what's happening, so make sure you join us. It's always always good to see everybody. Appreciate it very much. And tonight at 6 o'clock with Reverend Terry Fitzgerald, she's doing a great sermon on letting it go. And boy, that could be a long sermon. So anyway, please join us tonight virtually with Terry. Join Bible study every Sunday morning at 9:05, and just Zoom on that. Love to have you there. Join us. And then join Pastor in his normal office hours on a Tuesday morning from 10 to 10:45, and you can log on through the WhatsApp. There's the link there. And don't hesitate to contact Reverend Ellen Witko, our pastoral care associate, who's ready to talk with you or email you, or you can email it or any time too, and that's also posted in What's Happening. On October the 27th, Living the Question from 10 to 11:30. Also, ACT, Will You Defend Democracy With Us? Can you spend 2 hours reaching out to voters in Wisconsin? Make sure that you visit What's Happening email on September 9th that just went out for all the details. We absolutely need everybody to vote in Wisconsin in favor of our democracy. Also, Pastor Ryan is our legal organizer for ACT. And thank you very much for being here today.
The grace and peace of Christ be with you.
And also with you.
My name is Chris Wilson, and it is my joy to worship with you, church, on this day. I appreciate having this time to be in community with you, and I appreciate that all of you make time to be with us in your busy lives. The service order has been posted on YouTube and emailed out, so please feel free to download it. Before we begin, let us pause for a moment and take a deep breath. And take another. Friends, God calls us to gather. Let us give that call voice. Who can speak of all the glory of God? The full totality of it all, stars, seas, mountains, galaxies? No, not one can utter all the beauty of God, except perhaps in this way, to be a student of the universe, listening and delighting in the intricacies of creation, to be part of the human community, dancing in the streets with brothers and sisters, listening for stories, sharing in tears and laughter, living in justice and righteousness with God in the world and with all God's creatures. Yes, in these small, simple actions, the glory of God is perceived, always becoming, but never grasped. Open my eyes that I may see my sisters and brothers and you in them. Open my ears that I may listen, and my lips so my mouth may proclaim your praise. Peace be with you.
And also with you.
Share a sign of peace by commenting on the live stream page, or send a text to someone, or simply shout peace to the world.
Peace, peace.
Just
Let us pray. God, when our brother Paul sought to calm the anxiety of the saints of your church in Philippi, he wrote them these words, "Rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I will say, rejoice. Let your gentleness be known to everyone. The Lord is near. Do not worry about anything, but in everything by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus." Let our ears receive these same words, for we are an anxious people. Let our hearts receive these same words, for we fear gentleness will be rejected when the world needs it so much. Let our bones receive these same words, reminding us of the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding and is guarding our hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. Gather us here, wherever and whenever we may be, and let your word take root in our souls, that we may be sisters and brothers to one another, working alongside each other as Jesus taught us, freed from the anxiety that shakes so much around us. In the name of our brother Jesus, this we pray. Amen.
Amen. People of God, we gather here to share those burdens that we have brought in here. So trusting in God's forgiveness, let us in silence confess our failings and acknowledge our part in the pain of this world. Before God and with you, the people of God, I confess to turning away from God in the ways I wound my life, the lives of others, and the life of the world.
May God forgive you, Christ renew you, and the Spirit enable you to grow in love.
Amen.
Before God, with the people of God, we confess to turning away from God in the ways we wound our lives, the lives of others, and the life of this world.
May God forgive you, Christ renew you, and the Spirit enable you to grow in love.
Amen.
Good morning. It is good to try to see you all here, but it's good to be here with you all today. I'm actually going to start our message today by sharing a song, but before I do that, I want to talk a little bit about what Jesus is teaching us today. And Jesus is teaching us a really hard story. He's talking about about some people that a king invites to a wedding feast, and a lot of them are all the rich and the powerful ignore the invitation. They're just like, yeah, king, whatever. They don't show up. They walk away. They even hurt the people who are sent the invitations. And so the king gets really angry, but then the king invites everybody, all the ordinary people, so to come to this banquet, to feast on it, and to have a part in it. And then those people are also now challenged with the work that the rich and powerful used to be challenged with. Now they've got to do it. But something's really cool about this message, because what it's telling us is that often it's everyday, ordinary people that are the ones who carry things forward. And so I'm going to share a song with you here, because it's one of Floyd's absolute favorite songs. He runs around the house singing it, and I'll be surprised if he doesn't here in a moment join in with it. but it's by Sly and the Family Stone, called Everyday People. And so I'm playing this for you so you kind of get a rhythm of what it is we're talking about. Sometimes I'm right, and I can be wrong. I can be wrong. And if you're not dancing with this, come on. It's no difference what group I'm in. I am everyday people. Yeah, yeah. See, if we got the whole group shot, you can see that everybody else on the screen here is moving along with this. That's right, you're doing this at home. That's right, we're moving along to it. Right. And I mean, come on, it's got Scooby-Doo and it's got to be a cool song. So we've got this idea of everyday people and we're all trying to get together. We're all trying to figure out how to do this, what to do. And you know fully well, every one of you knows that we're in a really unusual time. Like things are not what they should be. We're trying to figure out how to get back to school. If we should go back to school, how we're going to do it. Teachers are trying to figure out new curriculums. The whole thing is shifting. And in the midst of all of this, God is saying, yeah, you know what? It's going to be up to you, you everyday people, the butcher, the baker, everybody in that mix, the rich, the poor, all of you are going to have to figure out how we're going to do this together. And that's, in a way, part of what you're challenged to do is to be this everyday people, to work on it, to try to figure it out, to kind of work on how we can do this together. So we can be everyday people together. And if you get a little, you know, down about it or you're worried about it, Sly and the Family Stone have a great song for you to hook into. Remember that. Maybe dance a little bit. But remember that we're all pulling in this together, that Jesus challenges us to recreate this society. And this is a good moment to try to do that. Let us pray. Loving God, help us to be everyday people, to sing, to dance, but to also work together. Help us to understand that this is a difficult time for our parents, for our grandparents, for our teachers, and for us. But help us to pull together for a more just, for a more loving world. Let us pray the prayer which Jesus taught us, saying, Our Father, Mother, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us of our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. There we go. So today for the testimony of faith, it's actually on me. And I'm going to keep this very, very quick, but very much to the point. Please vote. If you haven't registered to vote, the last day to register in Anne Arundel County is on Tuesday, October 13th. You can go to the Board of Elections website, at the Maryland State Government site. You can look through Anne Arundel County, but please go and vote. I believe that our church should have a 100% commitment to every member having registered to vote. We're not saying which party to vote for. We're not going to do that. But you have an opportunity to participate in a democratic process. So please, if you have not done it yet, you have until Tuesday, which isn't a lot of time, but you can do it online. I made sure that I did it. It's possible to go and make sure that you get all of the things you need to register to vote. It does matter. It does count. The other thing is that Kathy McFadden offered up an opportunity through ACT. ACT is not doing a Get Out the Vote campaign this year, but we are supporting our sisters and brothers in Wisconsin, North Carolina, and Ohio. We have affiliates who have reached a point in their development where they are able to do really phenomenal Get Out the Vote campaigns. In fact, our affiliate in Milwaukee has teamed up with the Milwaukee Bucks NBA team, professional basketball team, to do this Get Out the Vote work. And so if you are able to participate in it, the Wisconsin calling stuff, there's information for how to join that team that's in our weekly update that was sent out at 7 o'clock on Friday morning. So you can go back to your email and find it and sign up. And it's just 2 hours, 2 hours of your life to call up a few people. And some of this is calling up people whose ballots were rejected. Some of this is calling up people who have a history of voting, but we're not sure if they're registered yet. Some of it is just making sure that that work gets out there. Whatever it is, that 2 hours is inclusive of training and also an opportunity to follow up with everybody to see how you feel afterwards. It's good work. I'll be doing it on October 21st from 6:30 to 8:30. So sign up if you can, but this is an opportunity to get involved in some ways to really connect with people directly around issues going on around that. So I hope you'll be able to do it. That's all I have on the testimony of faith. This is how everyday people make a change. God bless.
Listen now in the reading of Scripture for the word and wisdom of God. We open our hearts to the word and wisdom of God. The first reading comes from the letter to the Philippians 4, verses 1 through 9. Therefore, my brothers and sisters, whom I love and miss, who are my joy and crown, stand firm in the Lord. Loved ones, I urge Euodia and I urge Syntyche to come to an agreement in the Lord. Yes, and I'm also asking you, loyal friend, to help these women who have struggled together with me in the ministry of the gospel, along with Clement and the rest of my co-workers, whose names are in the scroll of life. Be glad in the Lord always. Again, I say, be glad. Let your gentleness show in your treatment of all people. The Lord is near. Don't be anxious about anything. Rather, bring up all of your requests to God in your prayers and petitions, along with giving thanks. Then the peace of God that exceeds all understanding will keep your hearts and minds safe in Christ Jesus. From now on, brothers and sisters, if anything is excellent and if anything is admirable, focus your thoughts on these things: all that is true, all that is holy, all that is just, all that is pure, all that is lovely, and all that is worthy of praise. Practice these things. Whatever you learned, received, heard, or saw in us, the God of peace will be with you. So ends the reading.
Amen. Our gospel reading today comes from the Gospel according to St. Matthew, chapter 22, verses 1 through 14. And I read from the New Revised Standard Version today. Once more, Jesus spoke to them in parables, saying, "The kingdom of heaven may be compared to a king who gave a wedding banquet for his son. He sent his slaves to call those who had been invited to the wedding banquet, but they would not come. Again, he sent other slaves, saying, 'Tell those who have been invited, look, I prepared my dinner, my oxen and my fat calves have been slaughtered, and everything is ready. Come to the wedding banquet.' But they made light of it and went away, one to his farm, another to his business, while the rest seized his slaves, mistreated them, and killed them. The king was enraged. He sent his troops, destroyed those murderers, and burned their city. Then he said to his slaves, 'The wedding is ready, but those invited were not worthy. Go therefore into the main streets and invite everyone you find to the wedding banquet.' Those slaves went out into the streets and gathered all whom they found, both good and bad. So the wedding hall was filled with guests. But when the king came in to see the guests, he noticed a man there who was not wearing a wedding robe. And he said to him, 'Friend, how did you get in here without a wedding robe?' And the man was speechless. Then the king said to the attendants, Bind him hand and foot and throw him into the outer darkness where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. For many are called, but few are chosen. A difficult reading for a difficult time. But for the word of God in Scripture, for the word of God among us, for the word of God within us, thanks be to God. Please pray with me. O God, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be beautiful in your sight, O God, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. So, church, I want to talk baseball for a moment. I promise you that this relates to Jesus, but it might take a moment to make that connection. It won't hurt it. Won't hurt that we all know that I'm a diehard Tampa Bay Rays baseball fan. It doesn't hurt that on Friday, the Rays, with the third lowest payroll in Major League Baseball, beat the incomparable New York Yankees with the highest payroll in baseball to clinch the American League Division Series. It's a story that tells us that money cannot buy our way into everything, a story that I think Americans want to hear right now. It takes something else, and that's what I want to talk about. The sports writer Eno Saris wrote after Friday's game, "The Rays brand is commensurate with analytics, with outthinking the competition, with innovation and data, and they've earned that reputation. This collection of players was plucked from waiver claims, low draft picks and trades, and were employed strategically in unique ways to destroy the league. That's the brilliance we've come to know from them. Then they figure out how to piece the puzzle together in new ways that make it difficult for opponents. All of that takes hard science, it takes numbers, it takes a healthy research and development department that is empowered to help them make decisions." But Saris also points out that hard science, that analytics, that use of numbers, well, the Yankees have that too. What makes the 2020 Rays baseball team special is found in the words of the players following the victory. Consider Mike Brousseau, who hit the game-winning home run off a 100-plus mile-per-hour fastball at the bottom of the eighth against the Yankees' clutch-closing pitcher, a pitcher who was suspended at the end of the regular season for pitches he threw at Brousseau that seemed aimed at physically scaring him. Brousseau was totally passed up in the draft pick. Left is what they call an undrafted free agent. The Rays picked him up in their minor league system, and he worked his way up to the major leagues. He earned every right to brag about what he'd just done on Friday night. Nobody would have questioned that, but here's what he said after his home run. "Just trying to get a runner on and try to get the next guy up." That's it. He didn't talk about his home run being this incredible moment in his career. "Just trying to get a runner on and try to get the next guy up." That's what he was trying to achieve. Or Austin Meadows, the batter at the start of the lineup, whose home run tied up the game in the fifth inning. Did he talk about his own home run after the game? They had to actually really get him to do it. What he really said was, "It's unreal to be a part of, being part of that moment with Brousseau. You can't put that into words. It couldn't happen to a better guy. Or Tyler Glasnow, the starting pitcher, who effectively kept the team's toe-to-toe early on, despite only getting 2 days of rest. That was very storybook. That was crazy to go up there and have that kind of at-bat. Brousseau is such a good dude. It's so awesome that it was him. He's grinded all year long, kind of had sparing playing time, and just gone and did that in such a big moment like this. That, Glasgow continued, what makes us good is the mentality, how easy it is to come here to play. So many of the players here are guys that have been given a chance, and everyone just comes out and plays their hearts out. They can do what they do with the lineups and stuff because everyone is just so on board. Kevin Cash, the team's manager, said it this way. Hands down, the greatest moment I've been a part of in baseball. What that meant to this team. That was his reaction to this homer. The focus of the team is on being a team. On making it easy for everybody who comes there, everybody who's playing, to be a part of that team, to use their gifts to make it in there. And yeah, I'm kind of fanboying here about the Tampa Bay Rays, but all right. They are celebrating their teammates, honoring the game itself, and being phenomenal team players. Hugh Hecklow, a professor at George Mason, calls this thinking institutionally. More important than their individual lives, their individual careers, their names, is the game itself. And the team that plays it, all their practice, all their work seems focused on the institution of baseball and the Tampa Bay Rays, not themselves. They all did well, but they highlighted the moment that someone who ground his way up from an undrafted free agent to embodying the underdog status of that baseball team was universally how they felt about the game. Now hold on to that, because we're about to get into the parable. The parable of the wedding feast is a tough one. It's a parable, and as such is given to exaggeration in order to make its point. But it's hard to escape the parallel that the king who makes the invitations is God. Is this angry God really the God that Jesus teaches about? A God that not only burns an entire city, but then casts out a person just because he's wearing the wrong clothes, into an eternity of wailing and weeping and gnashing of teeth. Martin Luther, the German reformer who launched the Protestant Reformation, called this text a, quote, terrible gospel that he did not like to preach. On the face of it, I'm with him. I started with baseball. Luther didn't have that luxury. In its exaggerated way, the parable tells of the complete breakdown of a society. Let's start with the king. I mean, this is a king. The king invites the influential and powerful to the wedding banquet of his son. The banquet is supposed to signify the marriage of the church with Jesus. But the king has so little power or prestige in this society that the powerful people all ignore him. At best, they laugh. They make light of it. At worst, they abuse or even kill the king's servants. They go on with their business and their farming, caring little for the calls of the king, who is supposed to unify and lead society into a better world. Obviously, this king doesn't have the pull of the British monarchy when 29 million Americans tuned in just to watch Prince Harry and Meghan Markle get married. The bond of respect and love between king and subjects is entirely broken. It reaches a point where the king, recognizing how bad things are, destroys the remaining fabric of society by destroying the city of those who snub the invitation. Then, the king invites all those whom he hadn't invited before. Everyone. Anyone in the streets is invited to the banquet. No judgment is made as to whether they're good or bad, but the banquet's already prepared and somehow kept fresh through a military campaign against a city, but again, it's a parable, it's an exaggeration. This invitation to everyone that the servants could grab and reach and bring into the space represents a fresh start. In the earlier invitation to the powerful, there was a sense of reciprocity, the sort of sense we all get when we're invited to a polite society soiree. Maybe they knew that in receiving the invitation, If they showed up to the banquet, they would have to reciprocate the invitation by taking a role in the transformation of society. They would have to prioritize something besides their businesses and their farms, something besides their own power and their own profit. They didn't want to do that. Often we find ourselves today calling upon those who have power and influence to change things for us. We want them to fix it. We want them to do right. Do they do it? Well, today, not too long ago, in 2017, a new tax code was designed to funnel more money to corporations to create more jobs. It was designed to get the companies to build more factories, hire more workers, buy new equipment, fund more research, and expand. In some ways, that did happen. Investment in those things did go up, but not by as much as that money went in to padding profits, increasing dividends, and something called stock buybacks. In a sense, the powerful and the influential, when called upon to increase wages and give more people a better shot at a better life, went to their own businesses and farms first. They didn't hear the call. Historically, when some people of faith called for an end to slavery, many shrugged it off. The change would upend the economic and financial model that had made them wealthy. They shrugged off the responsibility that went with their wealth. And it might feel that many are still doing that today, too. And from what we know of social dynamics, we rarely, if ever, go against our self-interest. Why would a gazillionaire militate against his or her own wealth, even at God's invitation? It's a question for us all to think about. Why would we militate against our own wealth, even at God's invitation? In Jesus' parable, God recognized this. And so the king pivoted away from the powerful and the influential and toward a group of people who were not charged with responsibility for remaking society. Ordinary people, everyday people, homeless people, the written-offs who scrabbled to get by in the most ordinary ways, the ones who owned no land or farms and whose businesses, if they had one, never had a real shot at being listed on the New York Stock Exchange. They, and by they, I do mean you, were invited to the royal feast. But like the powerful and influential, the invitation was reciprocal. It still was reciprocal. There still was a responsibility put upon them in order to accept the invitation. There was an expectation to remake society towards a just and inclusive society that favored the poor and the ordinary, the outcast, and the ones who had not been included, the one that gave everyone a shot at a good and beautiful life, that expanded the invitation to the wedding invitation, or wedding banquet. Now, in a sense, this is where we are today. It's the role of the church. We are in a place where God is moving around us, often unrecognizable from other guests, meeting and greeting and getting to know the people of this society. Our church's role is to be a banquet hall in this parable, a place where people can gather, discuss, develop, and be equipped to be the saints that God is calling us out into the world. But while the invitation is freely given, there is an expectation that we do something to rebuild the broken society around us. This is what is meant by that poor bloke without the wedding robe. It's really a perplexing story in that wedding robes were not a part of Jewish culture in Jesus' time. People dressed in their festive best, much as we do today. The wedding robe is instead a symbol of the people who are doing God's will, building up the beloved community, building up the team, creating that sort of institutional society that can include, invite, and celebrate. The guy without a robe was present. He showed up to church, let's say, but he wasn't doing anything constructive with it. He wasn't studying. He wasn't trying to create. He wasn't trying to relate to the people around him nor the world around him. He displayed no curiosity or creative prophetic imagination about what was possible. His gifts, as doubtless he had them, were not employed in building up the kingdom or the kingdom of God. He partook of the feast, but did not return the favor that God asked of him. He was, in a sense, in the same league as the powerful who had ignored the invitation in the first place. The role for our church is to perhaps be a little more than a banquet hall and a place for welcome. It is absolutely that, and I am thrilled and gratified beyond measure as people who have never physically darkened this church's door have been able to take advantage of this new moment, this online moment, to find and be welcomed here. We're serious about that. Hospitality is truly one of the first principles of Christianity, and we have a job to do in that regard, especially as today is National Coming Out Sunday, and we recognize that so many have been turned away from that door and denied a place at God's table. We have a role to expand that welcome. But we should also take a page from the Tampa Bay Rays. See, baseball is truly divine. We have to learn how to become a team focused on the kingdom of God building work to which we are called. Our worship service is about equipping ourselves, yes, but it is also not about us. It is about God. It is about connecting ourselves, as we might do at a wedding banquet, to be better aware of how our gifts might be better employed in building this kingdom. And I use the word kingdom instead of kingdom here to denote the new moment of invitation and work that we all do as kinfolk, one with another. We develop those bonds together that celebrate when one gets a home run, especially one who has worked so hard to make that moment happen. We seek together the call of the Spirit to the work we are called to do, and we employ our talents and our treasures in the service of getting that work done. That's the invitation that we have been given to this banquet. We have been given an invitation to work together, sisters and brothers. We have been given an invitation of a richly made feast, to expand that invitation to people who might not have heard it the first time, or the second, or the third, or the fourth, or the 77th time. We have an opportunity as a people of God to look around us and see that, yes, there is a broken society. And the way to fix that society is not to constantly hammer people over the heads with what is right and what is wrong, but to invite, to create relationships, to nurture those relationships, to nourish the people of God, and to evoke this vision, this teamwork, this joy of being together, that is so much more powerful and compelling than our own businesses and our own self-interested pursuits, that actually our self-interest is pulled towards being the community of Christ together. I am grateful that we are able to do this, that we have an openness to this, that we can continue this work. I don't know how Tampa Bay is going to do against Houston on this afternoon. But I am grateful that I have been able to watch a team build itself up. And I am grateful for all the ways that we have found in this present pandemic moment as a church to build our team up. But I know that we have so much more to do. There is a society out there that is shattered. Just this morning in Bible study, that was one of the most popular prayers. Was asking for prayers for healing and for work in a society that feels broken and shattered. We have work to do. But I believe as we build our team up together, as we work together, as we relate to each other, as we take seriously that we can't just partake of the buffet, but actually we have to do the work that God is calling us, that we will do it one with another, just as Jesus has called us. The Lord be with you. Amen. Friends, on your screen is an invitation to give to the work of this congregation, the United Church of Christ of Annapolis. The money that you are able to give, we know represents hard work on your part. Work that you have done, work that your family has done, money that you have saved and set aside for a particular time and purpose. We are grateful for all of the gifts that you give, for we are called to employ those gifts for the building up of the beloved community. We also remind everybody that we have a fund set aside as a relief fund for those who are struggling right now. If you want to give to that fund, you can specify that in your giving online or in your check, Or if you need resources from that fund, reach out to me or any one of our deacons, and we can help get access to that. People, we give you thanks for all your gifts and your giving. But now we're going, as you consider what you're giving, we're going to turn to a special treat. The Central Atlantic Conference gathered for its annual meeting a few weeks ago, and they pulled together some songs. And so we're going to hear I Love to Tell the Story, which features also a member of this congregation who participated in that as well. Amen. We do love to tell the story. People of God, we are grateful for, and I know that so many of us miss singing together as a choir. We miss singing together as a church. We miss singing together as a place. We miss praying together. We miss being together. This is a substitute, but it's not the same, and we know it. But we give thanks for all the ways that we're supporting one another's, and for all of those who were singing in their living rooms. God bless you too. I certainly was. Friends, we give you thanks for all of your giving. Yes, let us hear the doxology. People of God, we have come into this place, this virtual space, with prayers that we have brought into this, prayers of hope, prayers of joy, prayers of sadness, sorrow, and longing. We now take a moment to share these prayers together, and if you wish to share them during this live stream, you may type them in to the chat section here on the YouTube page. And if not, we will hold those together nonetheless as we hold a moment of silence to pray for all of the prayers that we are bringing into this space. A prayer lifted up by Sandy is for National Coming Out Sunday. Prayers for all those who are questioning. Our prayers that they find the strength to live their truth. God, in your grace and mercy, hear our prayers. Amen. Prayers for all who suffer from mental illness and addiction, that they may be comforted. Yes, we also recognize that we are coming upon World Mental Health Day, a moment to recognize something that people live with every single day. And so we as a church bind our prayers to theirs. God, in your grace and mercy, hear our prayers. We offer up a prayer for Sandy's mom, Joan, who is continued in healing, is in a rehab center, and we know so much. She was able to greet our Bible study this morning over the phone, expressing how much she missed that. So we pray for Joan, and we pray with her. And if you wish to reach out to her to send her a card, just write to our church, and we can share with you the address. But Joan, we pray with you, God, in your grace and mercy, for this time of rest and healing, hear our prayers. Amen. Yes, I'm just going to throw in here, because it's mixed in here, prayers for these hymns that connect us on emotional and spiritual levels, that remind us that we are the beloved of God, that lift up our souls in every way, shape, and form. God, in your grace, hear our prayers. Prayers of, Rick offers up a prayer of blessing for all God's creatures. Allow them to slow your mind and bring you a sense of peace. I'm not sure if that squirrel jumping around on my porch right now is slowing my mind, but I certainly pray for all the ways that observing that does change how we see the world and how we can slow our minds and change our reflections to remind ourselves of what God is inviting us to in the world around. God, in your grace, hear our prayers. Prayers offered up from Hildy for her friend with pancreatic cancer. She starts chemotherapy this Wednesday. Hildy, we pray with your friend, God, in your mercy, but also her God's grace as she is able to go in for treatment in a really good spot. God, in your grace, hear our prayers. A prayer from Greg for his co-workers, Gina and Dave, who are recuperating from a fifth surgery and awaiting the results of a biopsy, respectively. Greg, we join our prayers for your friends and fifth surgery and awaiting the biopsy results. God, in your mercy, hear our prayers. Praises of friendship for different viewpoints, that we can look past the differences and see our hearts, but also for the prayers of work that it takes to be able to see one's hearts, and for the vulnerability and this courage that it takes to be vulnerable in a time such as this. God, in your mercy, hear our prayers. We add our prayers as well for Carl and this Elizabeth as Carl continues his procedures to heal, to get better from cancer. God, and we pray as well for Elizabeth, caring for him and for their dog and for their whole household. God, in your mercy, hear our prayers. We offer up a prayer as well for Kathy, a stalwart of this church who is going in for back surgery in a few days. We pray for her, for the strength, and we pray for Mike as he cares for her in her recovery. And we pray for the patience that healing takes as well. God, in your mercy, hear our prayers. A prayer here offered up for a vaccine for COVID. And so we pray for that vaccine. We pray for all of the thousands of people across the world working on trying to find that, and for the wisdom that they are able to bring together. God, in your mercy, hear our prayers. And a prayer as well for humanity, for peace, for political calm and unification of nation and people, for mental health, both chronic and situational, shut down another, and for family, and for a family friend also with pancreatic cancer. God, in your mercy, in your grace, hear our prayers. We offer up a moment of silence here in this time, for all those prayers that we have not spoken or shared in this place, but which weigh on our hearts, our souls, and in our bones. And we bring this together with the prayer for peace. O loving God, Spirit of hope and peace, lead us from death to life. Lead us from falsehood to truth. Lead us from despair to hope, from fear to trust. Lead us from hate to love, from war to peace. Let peace fill our hearts, our world, our universe. Peace, peace, peace. People of God, go from this place and watch a really good baseball game this afternoon, or not. Friends, before we close, I invite you as well to join us for the coffee hour where we get an opportunity to look at one another face-to-face across a screen using the joy of electrons in worship to be able to connect. But we invite you to join us wherever you are. We thank you. And friends, go from this place to love and serve God in all of your ways. Be filled with the Holy Spirit in every one of your steps. Remind yourselves to slow down every once in a while, to take a look at the world around you, all of creation, to see and hear and listen and let that rest in your soul. Bless you as you go into from this place. Bless you as you connect with neighbors. Come to the wedding banquet, but come to the wedding banquet knowing full well that God has called you into something. That calling is there, resting in your bones. It's always there. Ignore not that calling, for that calling is your wedding gown. Go from this place to love and serve God in all your ways. Amen.
Let us close with the grace. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the companionship of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore. Amen.